Hi, I'm Tracy Watts. Welcome to Mercer Health News. Our topic today is getting the most value from your data. And my guest is Leah Malof. Leah is a leader in our data and analytics group. Thank you, Leah, for being here.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Tracy. Good to see you.
So, Leah, I have often heard you say that more data does not mean more value. So whether or not an employer has a data warehouse for their health and prescription drug claims, how do they get real value from their data?
I think the most important word that we're talking about here is value. And value is a subjective term. And most employers rely on their various vendor partners to bring reports to them and for them to present the data from their point of view, meaning how they define value. Instead, we would suggest that it makes more sense to get more value out of the data is if an employer thinks about what their questions are. What do they want to get out of the report from those various different vendors? And at the end of the day, challenging their vendor partners to answer their questions is going to make sure that they're getting the most. What's also interesting is that employers should be thinking about the various stakeholders within their organization because they might have a different point of view in terms of what value means. And so looking at it holistically is going to make sure that they get the most.
So what questions should they be asking of their data?
Well, I can tell you the top three questions that we've been hearing from employers lately. The first one's probably the most obvious, which is what's driving our trend? And it's a really simple question, but sometimes the answer isn't necessarily always actionable. So I think it really challenges everyone to go a bit deeper in answering that. The second question that we hear a lot is, are our programs working? More and more employers are engaging in various different point solutions, and they're just not sure is all of that investment working for them. And then the third one, which has really been more of an interest lately, is in segmentation of the population. We know that employers have different types of jobs. They have people in different locations. They have different salary banding. Even more recently, there's a lot of discussion around personas and even ethnicity. And how do those factors change how people consume care, how people engage in the healthcare system, and even the health profile within those different segments that might challenge an employer to really manage them differently.
So that's really interesting. Will you walk us through an example?
Let's see. So I think probably the first one is probably the most obvious question, which is what's driving trend? I'm sure every employer hears this in every single report. It's those high-cost claimants and specialty drug claims. Now, that answers the question. Question is, what's driving trend? Answer is high-cost claimants and specialty drugs. But it leaves a lot of employers hanging about, well, what do I do with that? What do I do about it? And so if you use the data to go a little bit deeper, we might be able to find some opportunities. So here's an example. What if we looked at high-cost claimants and looked at them and said, how many of them are having repeated admissions? How many of them are having multiple ER visits? What does that tell us about that group? Could it be that they're having side effects of the disease, side effects of a specialty drug, side effects of chemotherapy that in part might be able to be mitigated? And if you can do that through case management, such as home care services or other types of support within the family while a patient is home, you might be able to, one, affect the quality and course of that disease process, as well as reduce the cost to the plan. Another element around high-cost claimants to think about is relationships. If you look at a high-cost claimant, let's say it's a spouse or child who's having many inpatient admissions or ER visits. Imagine you're trying to be at work and you know your child or your spouse is going to the ER 5 times, 6 times, 10 times, and it's not uncommon to even see 20 times. How is that employee performing at work? Are they neglecting their own health through that process? And so what can an employer do to begin to think about how do they support the whole family, not just that high-cost claimant? That's just one sort of simple example of how you use data to go deeper.
Okay. You know, another question that you said employers often ask is, are their programs working? Do you have an example of how you can use data to validate that?
I can't tell you how many times we hear that question. And if you think about the word working, working is in and of itself not objective. You can't measure working. And as we talk with employers all the time and say, well, what does working mean? And all of a sudden you sort of say, well, they told me I'd get a return on investment. Well, is that all you want to know? Is it just the financial impact you expect? Now, if we think about, here's a common example, like a diabetes program. Do we expect that in 1 year, as a result of engaging in a diabetes solution, that all of a sudden all those financial costs are going to change? That's a pretty big expectation. So we want to sit down with our employers and really understand what does working mean for them so that we can measure it holistically, not just the finances. That's just, you know, one element. Another one that's coming up around programs working that a lot of employers don't think about is when they have lots of different point solutions. Mm-hmm. Well, and they get engagement reports. Here's all the people engaging in program one and program two. Well, what if it's exactly the same people who are participating in all the point solutions and you're really only touching 2% of your people? Now the investment is very different when it's 2% of your people versus every single one of these programs. So we're looking at understanding true engagement across a population. So that's just a couple, and there's lots of examples.
So one of the common reports that I see when we look at data with clients are these risk stratification reports. And typically the client is just looking at, did my risk get better or did we see improvements? But could you just go a little bit deeper than that? Like, what should employers really be doing with that risk stratification data?
Right. So depending on the capabilities of who's producing that risk score, one of the ways that we within our analytics practice at Mercer like to use risk is when we can look at the population and stratify people into low risk, moderate risk, and high risk based on those risk scores. And when we look at those people, if we can look at their top episodes by cost and top episodes by volume, we can start to see if there's an opportunity to engage people early. As employers try to think about where should I invest my time, high volume, high dollars is probably a great place to start. Most recently, we are seeing things like joint disorders show up in that low risk group. We also know joint disorders and other orthopedic episodes can show up in moderate and high risk and more cost. So if we see it's showing up early, it's high volume, it's high cost, that is a great opportunity to think about how do we identify these people early? How do we think about steerage? How do we think about programs to support them and the choices that they're making in their orthopedic care?
Wow. So this is a lot of good information. You know, before I let you go, I just have to ask, what question, or maybe it's a couple of questions, should our listeners be asking about their data, but they probably are not?
I guess, you know, whether our employers have their own data warehouse or whether they're relying on various vendor partners, I would say to our employers, start with your questions and then go to your vendor partners and say, hey, I've got 10 minutes with my executive team. What are the top three things I should tell them? Make sure that you're distinguishing between the data that's information versus something I can do something about. That's one. And the second is give them your questions. If you've taken the time to understand what your questions are, have your vendors and your data warehouse or anybody you work with come prepared to answer your questions based on what you want the data to tell you and how you're going to get the most value from it.
That is really great advice, Leah. Thank you so much for joining me today, and thank everyone for joining in. We look forward to seeing you next time.